Okay, the final item of business this evening is a members' business debate on motion 13189 in the name of Bob Doris on tackling the misuse of off-road vehicles. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Bob Doris to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr. Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My thanks to fellow MSPs whose support has enabled me to secure this members' debate on tackling the misuse of off-road vehicles. Increasingly, communities across Maryhill and Springburn are impacted by the misuse of off-road vehicles, often, but by no means exclusively, these are often quad bikes. These can cause a regular and persistent nuisance on our streets, pavements and in our parks. They can cause fear and alarm, as well as significant damage. Many of us have witnessed the damage caused to the surfaces which have been caused by off-road vehicles, not least of all in our parks and our grassed areas. However, it is the human damage and devastation that I want to draw to the attention of MSPs this evening. In doing so, I want to speak a little about David Gow. David was killed when struck by a quad bike on Balmore Road in February last year. He was 79 years old. David and his family were robbed of celebrating his 80th birthday. The events around David's killing remain subject to legal proceedings, so I'll say no more in that regard. However, this evening I am joined in the public gallery by his son Craig and his fiancée Donna, as well as David's brother Alan, his wife Marion and his son Gordon. Alan is also a local councillor representing the area where David lived and so tragically killed. A quad bike has taken so much from David and his family. David should have been with his daughter Nicola to celebrate his granddaughter Renata's wedding. David missed his grandson Craig's graduation, his granddaughter Jessica's 21st, his grandson Cameron's 18th, and his brother Alan's 60th. David will also miss the wedding of Craig and Donna later this month, where he would have been over the moon to welcome his wee step-granddaughter Maya, whom he adored formally, into the family. I'll return to say more about David later, but it is important that we never forget the devastation and loss that the misuse of off-road vehicles can cause. Now, I want to be clear, Presiding Officer, there are many responsible users of off-road vehicles. This is not about demonising any group. There will also be those who don't understand or realise the risks and dangers inherent in the inappropriate use of such vehicles. Such riders not only put others at risk, but also themselves. We must reach out to that group to inform and to educate them. However, let me be blunt. There's a third group that, for whatever reason, just don't seem to care. Sometimes they cause nuisance or danger as a lone rider. At other times, in larger groups, which can not only increase the risk to the safety of the community, it can also be hugely intimidating. Myself and Councillor Gow met with Police Scotland, and it was clear from that discussion there's also a fourth group emerging. Those that use motorised cycles, often adapted to be able to travel at high speed, and often used to speed about communities and in our town and city centres, at times, but not always servicing deliveries within the so-called gig economy. Police Scotland are increasingly aware of the dangers that inappropriate use of such vehicles can cause. Our legislation and our enforcement powers are playing catch-up with these growing issues. Police officers have the thankless task of tackling the abuse, misuse and misery often caused by off-road vehicles. Pursuing someone driving such vehicles illegally puts officers, those that they pursue, and the wider public at risk. When off-road vehicles are confiscated, they are often returned to the owner within days of the vehicle being seized. Fines, if levied, don't seem to deter. The police need greater support, Presiding Officer. My colleague Anne McLaughlin was, until recently, the MP for the area David Gowan stayed. Anne brought forward a Members' Bill to the UK Parliament to require the registration of off-road vehicles, a wholly reserved matter to Westminster. But Anne's bill secured strong cross-party support, but unfortunately the bill fell upon the dissolution of the UK Parliament. However, the then UK Parliamentary Under-Secretary of State for Transport, Guy Opperman, agreed to establish a task force to look at the wider issues caused by off-road vehicles and was sympathetic to vehicle registration. I very much hope we can work together across party and across all levels of government to support progress on the misuse, on tackling the misuse of off-road vehicles. Myself and Councillor Gough have therefore written to Lillian Greenwood MP, the new UK Parliamentary Under-Secretary of State for Transport. We wish to meet her to discuss these matters further. I was also encouraged to hear reported comments from the UK Home Secretary in the press about potential action over fines, confiscation powers and the power to destroy certain off-road vehicles. There was no mention of potential vehicle registration, a key component to help identify and to confiscate off-road vehicles. To our Scottish Government, I would ask that a working group is established here in Scotland on this matter. Many aspects of road safety, education, policing and enforcement will be devolved. I am sure that Police Scotland and COSLA could be key partners in any working group, as well as various other organisations. If there is to be UK legislation, it would also help to inform the Scottish context also. I ask for that commitment from the Scottish Government this evening. But I want to end by returning to David Gough and his family. David was a son of Postle Park, a talented footballer, which took him to Jersey for a time, and a player and captain of Postle FC for many years, a painter to trade, a husband to Lorna, who he met at a football dance in St Gregory's Church Hall in 1972, and who he was devoted to until Lorna Sad's passing in 2014. His son Craig described David as a great family man, a great friend, a great colleague. He was an extremely intelligent and fiercely independent man who he was lucky enough to have known in all those capacities. Presiding Officer, in closing, I very much hope this evening's debate can provide a fresh impetus for Scotland's Parliament and our Scottish Government to work in partnership to do all we can to protect our communities from the misuse of off-road vehicles and protect other families, such as the Gough family, who have faced such tragedy.
Thank you, Mr Doris. We now move to the open debate. I call first Annie Wells, to be followed by Claire Baker. Around 4 minutes. Ms Wells.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to pay my respects to David's family in the gallery today and send my heartfelt condolences to you. And I would also like to thank Bob Doris for bringing this debate forward. Bob is my local MSP, and I'll happily work with him going forward on anything we can do. Improper use of these vehicles has negatively impacted communities across Scotland, most notably in terms of incidents of antisocial behaviour and the risks it poses to the public safety. Antisocial behaviour can broadly be defined as behaviour that causes or is likely to cause alarm or distress to other people in different households according to citizens' advice. This behaviour can range from vandalism to intimidation, harassment and excessive noise. All these examples of antisocial behaviour have often stemmed from the misuse of off-road vehicles in areas like dedicated footpaths and public roads, and also in our lovely parks. And unfortunately, this has been an ongoing problem in Glasgow, as Bob and I know only too well. Where I live, I can look out my window every night and I see quad bikes and unlicensed motorbikes jumping about, no lights on them, no helmets, just zooming about the place. And they don't have any regard to public safety or that of any other vehicle users. So last June, I wrote to Police Scotland. I submitted an FOI request on the number of incidents in Glasgow involving uninsured quad bikes and motorbikes. But more specifically, I asked, had there been a spike in how it might have pertained to youth violence and what Police Scotland was doing to address the problem. While I did attempt to get this information, I was informed that the lack of vehicle insurance offences are not subcategorised into type of vehicle. And given how widespread this issue is, I was delighted to see Anne McLaughlin take her bill through the UK Parliament. And it's a shame now that Anne's not there to carry that work forward, because the bill itself would make... Sorry.
Yeah. Doris.
I thank Annie Wells for giving way and for her kind words. But myself and Councillor Gough met Police Scotland. They identified the lack of data. That's something they're actively trying to, to work on, but I thank Annie Wells for highlighting that. We need proper data to inform potential legislation.
Annie Wells.
Yeah, and I totally agree with Mr Doris. We do, because that bill itself would have made registration for certain types of off-road vehicles mandatory, and it would have also required these vehicles to display registration plates, and that would have made identification and enforcement a lot easier for Police Scotland. And moreover, a great additional step, as we've heard, is that the UK Under-Secretary of State for Transport at the time agreed to creation of a dedicated task force to look at the wider problems associated with off-road vehicle misuse. And I would welcome the involvement of local authorities, Police Scotland, Scottish Government and any such working group to help address these numerous facets of the issue. Input from authorities from all levels of government in Scotland would be an absolute necessity to tackle this. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, misuse of road vehicles of varying types has been a continual problem in Scottish communities and especially in Glasgow. Aside from being a public nuisance, this problem has often resulted in criminal offences being committed and people being hurt or even, like Mr Gow, killed. This extends to both those using these vehicles and fellow drivers and pedestrians. That's why I support greater cross-party collaboration so that we can resolve the issue that blights our communities and the cost to human life of off-road vehicle misuse is tackled head-on. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Claire Baker to be followed by Ben McPherson in around 4 minutes, please, Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank Bob Doris for securing this afternoon's debate. Members may be aware that for a number of years I have been raising the issue of antisocial behaviour on quad and off-road bikes in my region of Mid-Scotland and Fife, and more broadly, including leading a similar debate in this chamber in 2014. During that debate, I highlighted the hard work of Sheila Cooper, who had collected thousands of signatures in support of her campaign for action on illegal bike use after her dog died following a collision with an off-road motorbike. I spoke of our responsibility to respond to the problem and to not be complacent about the degree of illegal off-road motorbiking and related antisocial behaviour in some of our communities. Since then, I have raised the matter on a number of occasions, responding to increasing instances of antisocial behaviour on farmland and grass and parks and on local pavements and streets. It is frustrating that a decade on from that member's debate, more progress has not been made. I have to say I have been disappointed in the Government's fairly weak response to these issues so far, but I hope today's debate does provide a greater focus for action. While I have focused on behaviour in the Mid-Scotland and Fife region, I know that similar problems exist in other parts of Scotland, and I have repeated the call for a national campaign and for measures to ensure that the police have sufficient powers and resources to deal with the issue. In Leavenmouth and Fife, the police have been proactive and have led a multi-agency task force to address antisocial behaviour on bikes. This is a social problem that cannot be solved by the police alone. Over the years, I have been happy to highlight and support the efforts of Kingdom Off-Road Motorcycle Club in Fife, who provide a controlled environment for children, young people and adults to enjoy off-road motorcycling alongside social awareness and re-education programmes. Kingdom is an example of how the appeal of off-road biking can be used to engage with young people and positively influence their behaviour. And they provide low-cost access to equipment and riding for those from disadvantaged areas, as well as an accredited learning programme equivalent to a National 4. National messages... if I have time...
Bob Doris.
I'm sorry for cutting across your speech. Claire, I wanted to first of all thank you for your ongoing work over a decade.
The chair.
I would like to thank Claire Baker, Presiding Officer, for her ongoing work for over a decade in this area. I wonder if Claire Baker would agree with myself that this debate should be an impetus to get some strong partnership working between Scottish and UK governments. I think there's a crossover between reserved and devolved powers, and actions by both governments should complement each other to deliver the best for the communities that we both want to see.
Claire Baker, and give the time back.
Thank you. I have seen the positive effect of cross-party working in Fife. I've described how they've done that in Leavenmouth. I'll go on to talk about registration and whether that is the solution here. I know it's something that other MPs have looked at over the years at a UK level, but I think we need to think clearly about what we expect registration to achieve in tackling this issue, but I'll talk about that towards the end. So national messages could be clearly communicated that those using off-road bikes understand the risks they are taking, the laws that they are breaking and the consequences consequences of doing so. As we get closer to Christmas, there should be awareness raising to ensure that those gifting off-road bikes are also aware of the rules, potentially through a campaign among retailers to encourage responsible sales and to ensure that buyers have a full understanding of the law. Not all bikes will be purchased through traditional sellers. Bikes are passed on once outgrown or they're sold through informal means, and we need to be able to get information on those responsibilities and legalities for those people as well. The motion refers to the Off-Road Vehicle Registration Bill, which was being progressed at Westminster by Anne McLaughlin. And I recognise she introduced the bill in honour of her constituent, David Gow, who sadly died after being struck by an off-road bike while crossing the road to his home, and a tragic consequence of the type of behaviour we are talking about today. And I thank Bob Doris for sharing the impact of the loss of David to his family with us this evening. While a registration scheme has the potential to help police more easily track down and identify vehicle owners, there is a need to ensure it will be effective in addressing those who are acting irresponsibly. The existing... would I have time?
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank you very much to Claire Baker. You were saying about identifying not only the bike but the perpetrator as well. Since March this year, and I'm trying to be... to give you information, since March this year, Police Scotland in the North East have been using Select DNA. It's a light spray that is harmless to skin or to clothes, and they spray it when someone is not using a bike legally, but it can identify someone later on to have been at the scene.
Claire Baker, again, I can give you the time back.
Yeah, I am aware of that type of policing model. That's really positive. I think it identifies the struggles the police have. They can't pursue somebody who's on a bike, but it's a way to try and secure identification. And it might, you know, we need to make sure that that is available through all forces. Sometimes we find that some police force will have an effective method. It's not always shared, or it's not always available to have the resources in all areas. But yeah, I'm aware of that as a tactic. So the existing voluntary registration scheme is a means mainly to deter theft and retrace bikes. So we need to think about whether a mandatory scheme would help to prevent activity that is already illegal. The key challenge for the police is identifying the bike, and registration will only assist if they already have the bike. Identifying users is often have to be done with the support of the community as part of a wider approach that addresses the antisocial behaviour that has impacted on our communities for far too long. And at a school visit in Parliament yesterday, parents raised with me their concerns about the safety for their children due to illegal quad bike activity in their area. The area is within a stone's throw of the charity Kingdom's off-road track, and people should be using the track. And as Bob Doris explained, there are some people using bikes who are just there to have fun. They have no regard for others. And we must get on top of this issue before more people are hurt. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Baker. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Carol Mock in around 4 minutes. Mr McPherson.
I thank my colleague Bob Doris for bringing this really important debate on the misuse of off-road vehicles to Parliament. As have others have emphasised, this is a very serious issue in many of our communities, including the one that I have the privilege of representing, and is a growing challenge and issue, and one that has just been emphasised that we need to get on top of. As other colleagues have emphasised, those partaking in the misuse of off-road vehicles are a small minority in our communities, and often young people and often minors as well. But a small minority, and we must make sure that that point is made. But it is a minority that is causing a lot of difficulty. Others have talked about their work on these matters for some time. For me, when I was elected in 2016, there was a trend then in my constituency where a minority were stealing motorbikes from across this city, driving them around the city dangerously and in an antisocial manner, and then coming to my constituency, continuing in that behaviour, and then burning them out. Police Scotland reacted to this along with other partners through Operation Sortiria and significant youth work interventions, and a difference was made. Trends were changed. The issue didn't go away, but it wasn't the everyday concern and nuisance anymore that it had been for a number of years. Unfortunately, since the pandemic, and particularly this summer, there has been a rise of casework again in my constituency, this time primarily in the Leith area. There is a new trend that's emerging, partly, I think, and is documented, influenced by social media. And this is quad bikes and off-road bikes, but also e-bikes, known as Saron bikes, which is one of the companies that make them. Driving dangerously along footpaths and on main arteries of pedestrian usage, like pavements, and generally, this is causing real difficulty. The small minority of people engaging in this are often involved in crime as well, whether that's theft, snatching phones, again, a trend that's worryingly growing, and violence. It is considered that some of this is linked to organised crime, which would make logical sense. So we really have a multitude of competing elements of challenge here. As others have said, this is difficult for the police, given the fact that many of those involved are minors, often don't wear helmets, and are in public areas where, if the police were to pursue, it would potentially create more danger for those around. So we do need a collective response, an innovative and creative response. I support calls for a working group. I support calls for greater focus on what and if new regulation would make a difference, and I support calls for engagement with the UK government as well as local authorities to come to solutions here. This is a much bigger problem from everything that I've observed and read in some cities in England. We don't want to get to that point in Scotland, so let's get ahead of this and try and really put the intervention in place and the collaboration in place to make a difference. Another area that's perhaps worth considering, but perhaps even more sensitive, is that a lot of the minority of young people involved here are wearing face coverings that logical conclusion we draw are not required. We might have had a bad summer, but I don't think balaclava wearing was necessary in Scotland at this time of year. So these are overlapping issues, very serious. Previously, when there was an increase in motorbike crime in my constituency, a young man died falling off a bike, and also a young child was hit by one and thankfully recovered fully. So let's not have any more tragedies, and my condolences to those who are with us today. Thank you to the government in advance for taking action on this.
Thank you. I now call Carol Mochen to be followed by Claire Adamson in around 4 minutes. Ms Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank Bob Doris for bringing this debate to the Chamber? And can I also thank David's family for allowing Bob Doris to share the tragic story in the Chamber this evening? I wanted to offer just a short contribution to this debate tonight, following a number of discussions with residents in my South of Scotland region over the summer break. Following those conversations, there is no doubt in my mind that off-road bikes and vehicles are being driven illegally and recklessly throughout Scotland. And if I give an example, I was in an area near the third in part of my constituency near where I live, on a door with someone, and there was a I would describe it as a dirt bike, I think that's the description, and it was being driven up and down the street, and residents were saying to me that they had tried to work with the community council and with the police, but it was an ongoing issue. So members have outlined many of the points that I would raise, but and I also know that my friend and colleague Claire Baker has raised this important issue many times in the Chamber, and I am really glad to be having this debate tonight right across the Chamber. I think we are in agreement that we do need to move this forward. Constituents have raised multiple issues around safety, fear, excessive noise, damage to fields and farmlands, to their favourite community walks, and of course to fencing, property and pathways, as other members have mentioned. Other members have mentioned the variety of vehicles, but I've learned tonight of more. So in my own area, it's sort of off-road bikes, quad bikes in particular, around sound and noise pollution, and these dirt bikes, as they're described. But the sort of adaptation of the bikes and of the e-bikes is something that I've just heard of tonight. Of course.
Doris.
Thank you to the member for giving way, who raises the variety of bikes. And I associate myself with Ben McPherson, who mentioned criminality in some respects. But there's a new fad. And as a dad, I get this. E-scooters that young people are desperate to ride just now and on the roads at the very youngest of ages. And these are the next generation of quad bike users and Saron bike users. And we have to tackle this with education at an early years level as well, because the amount of people we have on our streets just now riding bikes irresponsibly is only going to grow unless we tackle this at roots.
Carol Mochan, give you the time back.
Thank you. I thank the member for the intervention. I think it's absolutely right. What we're discussing here tonight is really trying to tackle it on all fronts so that we get it right, because the reality is that these vehicles are being driven right through the heart of our communities. It's been raised with me from local councillors to community councils. And there's no doubt in my mind that we must work with communities to tackle this issue. It causes them undue concern and stress, but as we've heard this evening, great safety issues with often very tragic outcomes. And we have heard that often, you know, there will be young people who will just not understand the risks to themselves and those tragic risks to their wider communities. But I do believe that working together is the answer. We need to get the correct legislation, but we need to do that with the communities. It's essential that we work together if we are going to turn a corner. And I'm really interested to hear what the Minister believes we can do here together in Scotland to make a difference. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Claire Adamson, around 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I won't take much time this evening. My colleagues know, I would like to say to the family as well, that I convene the cross-party group on accident prevention and safety awareness, which was established when I joined here in 2011. My reason for doing that is because I lost a teenage member of my family in a road traffic accident, so I have some understanding of the pain and the impact that that will have had and will continue to have on your family, and you have my deepest condolences. We have looked at the issue of quad bikes. We've looked at it, an issue of these are not toys as well, and we had to have serious conversations with the farming community and some of the people that work in forestry and other areas about the need for helmet use. And Emma Harper, I know, ran a campaign saying hang your helmet, where she engaged with the sellers of the quad bikes as well, and some of the farming magazines, to ensure that they stopped showing pictures of people on the bikes without their helmets, to try and get that message through that this is absolutely imperative. And last week we saw Charlotte Lawrence, 33-year-old forestry worker, killed in Pitwalkie. Absolutely.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thank you, Claire Adamson, for giving way. And it's actually really good that you've mentioned the Hang Your Helmet campaign that I was keen to support. And I know it's different because that's about farmers wearing helmets and safety in fields and on road as well. And it's different than what Bob Doris and others are describing when it comes to antisocial behaviour. But does she agree that it sounds like there is merit in the Scottish Government leading on this and taking some action?
Yes, absolutely. I think that we've known about the concerns around this area, but the cross-party group has also looked at emerging trends, and Bob has just mentioned the scooters. The e-scooters, of course, our Trade Standards Office and the Fire Service are really, really concerned about fire risk from the charging of these. And we have seen in other parts of the UK in particular, where they're more popular, pedestrians frequently been injured by e-scooters used on the pavement. So this is an emerging issue, and everybody has been so positive tonight and in highlighting the challenges that we have and mentioning that legislation has to catch up with these issues. And I think that's where you know, there's a willingness here to come together to ensure that we make some progress on this, because it's taken far too long for the government, a lot of it is reserved to Westminster, to recognise just how serious these problems are. And it's absolutely right, there are good organisations. There's one in South Lanarkshire, one in Livingston, that run
parks for quad bike use, and it's done with rules and regulations, and the young people are taught safety on top of everything. But it is an emerging thing, and we do have to get on top of it. So my ask tonight is, my colleagues in the room will know that, but I reach out to the Gough family. If there's anything we can do in the cross-party group, we're engaged in talking about these issues. I'm more than happy to meet with them and see if we can take something forward from that group within the Parliament.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call on Jim Fairley to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I first of all offer my sincerest condolences to the family of David Gough, who are with us tonight. Presiding Officer, I thank the colleagues across the chamber for their contributions to this really important and current debate, and I very much appreciate the subject being raised by Bob Dorris on behalf of his constituents here today. My farmer background, I've worked with quad bikes for 30-plus years, but I didn't realise until this debate was happening in here that it was such an issue in the urban sector. And saying that, the Scottish Government acknowledges the issues that have been raised in today's off-road vehicles, including quad bikes, being used inappropriately, recklessly and dangerously, and the impact that it's having on communities in terms of jeopardising the safety of all road users and the public. Often the misuse can lead to or involve linked to antisocial nuisance and more serious criminal behaviour. It can alarm residents, particularly more vulnerable people. It can damage lands, it can damage pavements, roads, local facilities, and such a misuse is not acceptable, and we need to work together to get that message across. We've got to address the problem where they occur and to try and change the law to give us more powers to do so. So, Presiding Officer, allow me to set out some of the Government's position in more detail. The enforcement of all traffic offences is a matter for Police Scotland, which operates independently of Scottish ministers, clearly. However, the Scottish Government in no way condones or disregards the rules of the road. No road user should disregard the rules of the road. Despite challenging financial circumstances, we are investing a record funding of £1.5 billion in policing in the current financial year. The Scottish Police Authority, working with the Chief Constable, will determine how to allocate its budget to meet those policing priorities. But be assured that the Scottish Government fully supports Police Scotland and its partners in dealing with the misuse of these vehicles under discussion in our debate today. The local policing teams are ideally placed to identify where the misuse of vehicles is causing risk and distress to the public, and to ensure that local knowledge and prioritisation of resources can best inform the approach required. And as has been mentioned a number of times tonight already, that local communities know better than most. So Police Scotland's Corporate Communications Department coordinates messaging on trending issues, and I hope that clarifies some of Claire Baker's issues there. They coordinate the messages on trending issues such as those under debate at the moment, and then are disseminated and circulated via local divisional social media. In terms of road safety campaign messaging, they coordinate with other emergency service partners, local government, and to ensure a consistency of approach. Additionally, in February 2024, through the Scottish Community Safety Network, some of its members, including those in local authorities, raised concerns about off-road motorbikes and quad bikes. And in response, we set out to the SCSN and its membership how Police Scotland were dealing with the issue, and highlighted the significant partnership work that is ongoing. And we encourage local partners to raise or continue to raise the issues locally with police colleagues. And Presiding Officer, Police Scotland has also extended the use of selected DNA tagging spray, which was mentioned by my colleague, Jackie Dunbar. The handheld tagging spray is used by officers to target offenders involved in antisocial and illegal use of motorbikes and bicycles, including electric bikes. So the spray is deployed as a very fine mist, which does not cause any harm to the dam or damage to the skin, clothing or property. But it doesn't wash off surfaces and can therefore help forensically link offenders after a passage of time. However, with registration, that might not be necessary, and that's one of the things that we really have to look at. Presiding Officer, in 24 and 25, we have committed a record of £36 million towards road safety. Of this, £10 million is being invested to enhance local road safety through the Road Safety Improvement Fund. And that includes £1 million to support Glasgow City Council to help reduce casualties and risks on their roads through the implementation of the measures which align with the principles of the safe system. But also let me highlight a road safety framework. Road safety is of paramount importance to the Scottish Government, and through the delivery of Scotland's Road Safety Framework to 2030, we've committed to marking Scotland's road travel to be safe for everyone. The framework sets out the vision for Scotland to have the best road safety performance in the world by 2030. And alongside our ambitious long-term goal, where no one is seriously injured or killed on our roads by 2050. And I know that's ambitious, but it's one that we've got to drive for. One death in Scotland's road is too many. And my sympathies are with the families of those who suffer such tragic losses. The children in Scotland's poorest areas are more likely to be injured by road traffic. Analysis shows that children on foot or bike are more than three times as likely to be involved in a traffic accident in the 20% most deprived areas in Scotland than in the 20% of the least deprived areas. Presiding Officer, previously Transport Scotland has funded a plea... Yes, absolutely.
Claire Baker.
I do appreciate what the Minister is saying about road safety, but that appears to... I might be mistaken here, that's the bigger issue around cars and other road usage. I think what members are concerned about here is off-road bikes, which are sometimes used on roads, but it's also causing problems in parks and public spaces. It's not always on the roads, it is in other spaces as well. So I'm not sure the road safety advice will, or I'm asking, will it address these type of issues?
Minister.
I'm merely giving an outline of all the things that the Scottish Government are doing and how seriously we take the issue. Presiding Officer, previously Transport Scotland has funded a police-led initiative for young people to produce and circulate a short film discouraging their peers from taking part in the theft or antisocial use of motorcycles. Now, this was found to help increase awareness of motorbike crime and the wider ripple effects it can have in communities. And looking ahead, analytical work is underway to establish the current scale and nature of the off-road biking challenge in Scotland. Identified findings flowing from this will be shared with the stakeholders through future meetings of the Motorcycle Focus Group, which last met in late July this year. Presiding Officer, prior to the election, as we've already heard, Anne McLaughlin had introduced a private members' bill on the Westminster registration of off-road vehicles. The legislation is in connection with these vehicles. Registration is reserved, and the Department of Transport and the DVLA were leading on the bill. It now seems likely that the UK Government may take forward Anne McLaughlin's proposed bill, I hope they do, or bring forward new legislation which broadly follows what has been proposed in Anne McLaughlin's bill. If so, we welcome this. We would, of course, prefer to be in charge of all such transport matters here in Scotland, but while this is reserved, we would expect to and will seek the opportunity to be fully and appropriately engaged in the development of any work the UK Government may be taking forward on off-road vehicles. In a similar space under the umbrella of off-road vehicles, let me turn briefly and specifically to e-scooters and e-bikes. E-scooters are covered by the same UK-wide laws and regulations that apply to all motor vehicles. As such, these scooters need to meet the legal requirements, including a valid motor insurance, technical standards, payment of vehicle tax, licensing and registration, and the use of relevant safety equipment to be used on public roads lawfully. In practice, though, it is very difficult to comply with all of these requirements, meaning that it would be a criminal offence to use them on the road. In Scotland, it is currently illegal to ride an electric scooter on a public road or pavement, cycle path, shared path or any public place. Ministers in the previous UK Government publicly stated their intention to bring forward a new regulatory framework to enable the use of e-scooters. Both primary and secondary legislation will be required, and therefore the timescales for when such a framework would be in effect remain unclear. As such, the Scottish Government would support calls for greater clarity on the UK Government's plans, and in particular on timescales for work to progress in this area. Transport Scotland will continue to engage with the Department of Transport as necessary to discuss its proposed regulatory framework. And if electric bikes or electric-assisted pedal cycles adhere to a certain criteria and requirements, including minimum power output for the electric motor, and that motor should not be able to propel the bike when it is travelling at more than 15.5 miles per hour, they are then classed as normal pedal bikes, and cyclists can ride them on cycle paths or anywhere else a pedal bike is allowed. Again, we will continue to engage with the Department for Transport on any developments in this area. I should also highlight that, as outlined in the updated Highway Code, that people must not ride in a dangerous, careless or inconsiderate manner when cycling, and they must obey all traffic signs and traffic signals. Now, clearly, again, that is reserved, but it is something we want to see concluded. Presiding Officer, in closing, I can reassure members across the Chamber and our constituents, including road users and pedestrians, that the Scottish Government takes the issue of the misuse of off-road vehicles very seriously, and we will continue to work with partners in Police Scotland and locally to seek to eradicate the instances of the misuse of these vehicles. I certainly will, yeah.
Bob Doris briefly.
Presiding officer, I'm very sure the Minister was just coming on to this, but obviously had a very specific ask about establishing a working group here in Scotland. And I would also note that I agree with the Minister. I wish all these powers sat here, but this is not a constitutional issue. This is about partnership working across government and with local authorities to deliver for our communities. So some reassurance that we will progress some of this.
Yeah, he's preempted me. I was going to say, in response to the ask from Bob Doris, I am very open to establishing a working group in conjunction with my colleague Siobhan Brown, who is the Victim and Community Safety Minister, and others to try and find the solutions to prevent another unnecessary tragedy as suffered by the family of David Gow. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.